Lovely good evening. Welcome to The Checkpoint. My name is Darren Bartlett, and I want to say thank you for being with us from right in the morning to this time and following our programming. And today we want to look at a special topic which we shall be breaking down, of course, with my guest ahead there. But the first important thing is for us to give you a preamble and understand what we're going to be talking about. Now, we know that the education and sports sector in Uganda has the mandate to provide education as a basic human right, a human right to all Ugandans. And the goal here is to equip learners, trainees, students with the relevant knowledge and skills that are important for socioeconomic development. And that falls in line with the social development goals from the UN. And that also include or emphasize inclusivity and quality education. But when we talk about inclusivity, what are we talking about exactly here? There are people with needs in this country, and here we want to look at how are they catered for when it comes to that social development goal that emphasizes equality or quality education and inclusivity. To be very specific. Now, this is a branch or a sector that is very delicate because we have quite a number of people in that bracket that we wanted to call inclusivity. I don't want to break it down because I understand it differently. Probably I understood it in my own way, but the expert is here who is going to tell us what inclusivity is and what constitutes inclusivity and financing of that particular branch in education. So Dr. Jock Patrick from Chambogo is here. He has joined me, and we shall be having a discussion with him one-on-one. So you can pass your messages on our different social media platforms, and then we can engage with you to the hour of 11. Good evening, Dr. Patrick Ojok. How are you doing today?
I'm fine, Darren. Good evening.
I'm okay. Yeah. I hope you had a good day.
Yeah, I had a good day at the second National Inclusive Education Symposium.
It happened today.
It's happening and it's continuing to tomorrow.
To tomorrow.
Yeah.
Okay. So now that you are having this symposium, first of all, let's start by defining what inclusive education is in Uganda or probably worldwide.
Yeah, thank you, Darren. I have a question for you.
Okay, I'm willing to answer.
It's about Messi and what's going on. How are you going to spice this show to make sure that you still get attention with Argentina playing?
No, football is a sport where, let me say like this, not everyone watches football. In my house, I am the only person who would watch football. The rest don't watch football. Family's house, they don't watch football.
So we are targeting the non-football fans.
We are targeting people who are not fans of, because there should be something for everyone. Imagine all TV stations were showing. People would just get bored.
All right. Yeah. Back to the question, what is inclusive education? First, I want to thank Urban TV for giving this topic a chance for discussion. When you talk about inclusive education, first of all, I would like to say that there's really no international consensus on what it is. So I may not give a definition per se. But inclusive education is all about meeting the diverse needs of all children, regardless of their differences in terms of socioeconomic backgrounds, okay, in terms of disability status, in terms of geographical location, race, or other forms of identities that usually orchestrate disadvantage. So it is about addressing the unique needs of the diverse groups of learners within the regular school system. So this is the idea of inclusive education. Literally, what it means is, in practical terms, a child with disability from Karamoja has a right to go and receive an education in the school which is nearest to his or her home without having to trot the country to look for a special school which is located nearest, for example, in Soroti district or in Lango region. So this child should go to school, be accepted in any ordinary school, and inclusive education is about access in the first place. Every child, regardless of these differences I mentioned, has a right to access education at all levels. But then inclusion is beyond access. The child who is in school is just a first step. If they are not supported to learn, then there will be no more than visitors in the classroom. So inclusive education is about participation. Mm-hmm. Participation in all school life, starting with teaching and learning in the classroom. Extending to co-curricular activities. There are instances where children with disabilities are denied participation in some school activities on the presumption, the incorrect presumption, that they cannot benefit from such activities. For example, a teacher who taking children for physical education behind a child with disability to take care of other fellow learners' books and other school supplies while the rest go to the field to exercise. That would be denial of participation. So it is about access, it is about participation, but it's also about achievement in terms of academic attainment. It is about inter-class transition, inter-cycle transition. So every child deserves all these. And in the end, we hope that through inclusion, every learner's potential to achieve something in life is harnessed, is maximized through a supportive and education system.
Quite an interesting and broad definition of what inclusive education is. And I've been going through my mind from the time I started going to school to when I finished school. I'm imagining there should be some policies, right? Do we have any policies anywhere in schools that support this whole concept of inclusive education?
Yes, we actually have had laws as well as policies. We have the most recent law, the Persons with Disabilities Act, which was passed in 2019 and gazetted in 2020. There are some interesting and progressive provisions in this act. One of it is that it prohibits discrimination in education at all levels on the basis of a child's disability. So if you deny a child with a disability admission to an engineering program on the basis of that child's disability, that constitutes discrimination. The other provision is that when you admit a child with disability to an educational institution, you must make the necessary modifications in the school system, including infrastructure, to make them accessible, friendly, and freely usable by the learner that you have admitted. And the Act stipulates that these modifications must be made within 3 months of admitting the learner. And by the way, we are talking about all levels of education, from nursery through to university. And then, of course, there are other provisions about the use provision of sign language services for those with language and communication barriers, provision of assistive devices like wheelchairs, like hearing aids,
yeah.
and also making sure that learning resources, the curriculum content, is available to all to those learners in accessible formats. So what we have seen, what is going on, for example, is that we have textbooks for maths, for science, for other stories in the traditional print formats. But there are learners with print disabilities who are unable to access the same content because they are in the traditional format. Now, Uganda has ratified the Marrakesh Treaty, which enjoins Uganda to make sure that all digital textbooks, for example, are converted to accessible alternative format for all learners with print disabilities. I had a painful story of a graduate who is blind, who studied law at one of the public universities in Uganda,
mm-hmm.
and had to go through the experience of reading large volumes of law books that were not transcribed for her in Braille. The university could not provide this service, so the student had to meet the cost of getting someone else to transcribe the constitution and other statutes that we're supposed to read. So now the laws that we have binds the university to provide these services to the learners with disabilities instead of the student meeting the cost personally.
Doctor, is there a correlation between financing and inclusivity in the education sector?
Yeah, I should say yes. First of all, education is not free in itself. Therefore, inclusive education comes with a cost. Before I even go to the exact question, maybe we should understand what is the cost of inclusive education. What are we spending on in terms of inclusive education? Many of the costs are actually the same for ordinary students, like the cost of teacher salary, the cost of building school infrastructure, the cost of scholastic materials. These are the same all learners need. But I wanted to highlight for this show what I would call the additional costs of inclusion that are related to disability that are overlooked in our funding arrangements of today. A person with a disability, a student or a learner with disability, incurs a lot of other costs related to their disability in order to function in the school at the same level with other learners of their age range. For example, whereas an ordinary child goes to school walking and running, a child with a physical impairment due to, for example, polio, needs to roll on a wheelchair. That wheelchair is not God provided. It has to be acquired. Moreover, after acquiring a wheelchair, the child cannot roll themselves to the school. There needs to be a personal assistant who can support this child from the home to the school. I'm not talking about the distance they're going to take rolling.
Yeah.
Then when this child is at school, there should be a personal assistant present to wheel the child around the school compound. So this is a cost that the ordinary children and their parents are not bearing. And then, of course, if you are to board from your home to the school using a wheelchair, the ordinary transport becomes a challenge. So there is again the issue of accessible transportation. I have heard with pain some stories where persons who use wheelchair have been either denied access to public transport because of their wheelchair, or they have been charged an extra fee because of their wheelchair. The other is a child who is blind comes to school, is admitted, but this child needs a braille machine. So this is an extra cost to the school and the child because of their disability. Then there is the issue of a sighted guide for this person who is blind because of mobility challenges. There are also costs that are required because of the presence of a child with disability by the school. For example, adjusting school infrastructure to make them accessible. Unfortunately, our architects and engineers train engineers traditionally to design architectural facilities with the presumption that their users are all able-bodied. Now, this able-bodied assumption or presumption made by those who design buildings and even technology devices cost us at other level, because when a school facility grant funded infrastructure is designed in a way that is not accessible, and then now there are children who cannot reach the head teacher's office because of the architectural barrier, who cannot access the library because of the same barrier. Now the law requires that you must break down the barrier, so you have to construct a ramp. So there are all these extra costs of educating a child with a disability that are not accommodated in the remittance of UPE, in the remittance of USE, in the remittance to universities and other tertiary institutions, not even in the scholarships that are given to students, and including scholarships given to students with disabilities. So the current funding arrangements have one key issue, that they do not take into account the extra costs that are borne by the family of a child with disabilities, as well as the schools that are hosting and educating learners with disabilities.
Now, I want to ask Kani, because when you put it that way, I'm trying to see how many schools have actually facilities to take care of the disabilities. And I kind of draw in government schools, which I expect to be funded by the ministry. Is there funding, or is there, are they facilitated financially to take care of those needs for each and every government schools before I come to policy for private schools?
Okay. If, when you ask how many schools have facilities for children with disabilities, first I want to make it clear from a policy point of view that we subscribe to the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which requires us as a state party to ensure an inclusive education system for all, at all levels. So what that means in practice is that all our education institutions must have facilities for learners with disabilities. But now back to your question, and in relation to funding. Currently, the records that I checked show that at primary and secondary level, the government is funding only 180 schools. If you break down these schools, there are different types of schools. We have what is called special schools.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of special schools, if I can glance at my records, we have around, we have 26 primary special schools. That is 7 private and the rest government aided. We have 4 special secondary schools. And then we have what we call units. Those are 66. And then unit secondary school are 9. In total, 180 schools. So in these 180 schools, there is a grant called subvention grant that the government sends to these 180 schools per child. The amount for subvention grant per child has grown from 7,000 in 2012-2013 financial year to now around 20,000 per child with a disability in 2021-2022 financial year. That is the amount that is sent to for a child with disability in these schools. Now, here is the issue. The issue, again, with the subvention grant is that it is not covering all the schools where there are students or pupils with disabilities. Remember, there are maybe over 3,000 primary schools in Uganda and so many other secondary schools. And if you take the world estimate of disability prevalence of 15% of every population, that means in every school, at least 15% is having, of the school's enrollment, is a child with disability. So if we are supporting children with disabilities in only 180 schools at secondary and primary, and then at university, government is supporting 64 students with disabilities per year since 2002. So the majority of the learners with disabilities enrolled outside the 180 schools, who is funding their education?
Do you have an estimate of a number in both primary and public schools of children with disabilities?
Yeah.
Any special?
Yeah, there's an estimate. It may not be accurate because of gaps in our data collection mechanisms. Hopefully, the newly launched EMIS, Education Management Information System, which again we are still grappling with utilizing it, will correct the data gap. But the data available so far, as of at least 2020, especially it was collected during the school closure, shows that we have at primary level around 172,864 children with disabilities, which is just under 9% of the total primary school enrollment. And at secondary level, we have around 8,945 students with disabilities at secondary schools, which is staggering 0.6% of the secondary school enrollment, which is over 1 million. So it is at that level. I don't have statistics at universities, but in my university at Kiambogo University, we have 179 students with disabilities enrolled at Kiambogo University. And I can almost affirm that Kiambogo University should be having the highest enrollment of students with disabilities, because again of the incorrect assumption out there that it is Kiambogo University which has the facilities and the equipment to support students with disabilities. But that should not be the excuse.
I want to follow up with I don't know if you have statistics to this, but even those who enroll, okay, there are different types of disabilities.
Yeah.
Are there those that supersede the other and those that are more disadvantaged than the other, that to a point that, for example, the blind, once they reach a certain stage, it looks like it's only God and mercy for them. But those on wheelchairs, perhaps, or maybe those on a walking stick, perhaps. Do you have those statistics to show us which one is the most disadvantaged?
I can't speak to that, but I want to correct something you said.
Yes.
I'm not saying you meant it.
No.
When we insinuate it's about God and mercy or even fate, when it comes to disability issues or other marginalized categories, I think we cannot surrender matters of education or even other rights of persons with disabilities to fate. Issues of disability are issues of human rights, the issues of citizens. Both legal and moral obligation on us.
For people.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So, okay. Yeah. Now I get you.
Yeah. Yeah. I just wanted to lay that off. Back to the issue on different types of disabilities. I think I must credit you for asking that question. For one reason, out there, many people take disability as a uniform or even homogeneous category.
Yeah.
Far from that assumption, disability is one of the most diverse category. It is heterogeneous. We have persons with intellectual or cognitive functional difficulty. We have persons with visual impairment, hearing impairment. We have persons with physical. We have those who have psychosocial and mental disabilities. There are those with developmental disabilities like autism. And so all these categories have unique needs different from the other. And this is where disability poses the biggest or most complex challenge to the education system, because there's no one unitary way you can design to respond to people with disabilities, because they are not a uniform category. Now, in terms of equity of educational attainment among persons with disabilities, there is a lot of disparity in favor of some categories. So the stats show that persons with physical disabilities, they are relatively favored in terms of educational attainment. They are those who have attained more. There are many more at all levels of education. And also when you go to employment, statistics show that there are also more in employment, persons with physical disability. For example, when you check the manpower survey of 2016-2017, which shows the employment standing, persons with disabilities stand at only 1.3% of all the persons in formal employment in Uganda, 1.3%. Now, among the 1.3%, 40% of the 1.3% are persons with physical disability. Impairment. So, again, that is a little bit attributable to the fact that when you address the accessibility issue for a person with a physical disability, if they can access the class, in most cases, their barriers are limited to access. And so they are more likely to benefit from the system when access issues are removed. But that is not true for other categories. Mm-hmm. But without losing track of your question, the other category that have attained relatively in education are those with visual impairment and hearing impairment. So the most disadvantaged, the most excluded and left behind categories are people with the cognitive and other significant disabilities. They usually, very few of them go beyond primary or even complete primary. Very few you'll find in secondary and university. And yet this shouldn't be the case. I have myself studied in the United States with persons with very severe disabilities. And you can't imagine the level of proficiency and competence that they demonstrate.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much, Doctor. I just want us to take a short break and then return. We'll look at more. We basically give more insight on the topic of the day. Let's take a break.